Hello everyone, and welcome to our lecture on signals and images. Today we will first have a look at what we mean by frequency domain by looking at Fourier series, and then we will define our Fourier transform. Following our definition of the frequency domain, we will have a look at the filters that we used last week and how they look in the frequency domain, and define different types of filter that are characterized by their frequency response. So let's start with a simple example of a 1D signal that is just a train of boxes back to back. Now in Fourier series, we will look at periodic signals. And this periodic signal, as you can see here, can be approximated very roughly by a sine wave that is the same frequency as our box train. But we can add different sine waves with higher frequencies. In fact, these are the harmonics of the original frequency, which are the integer multiplications of the frequency of the original signal. And as we add more of these components of different sine waves, we can see that the box train is getting approximated better and better. In Fourier series, we can represent any periodic signal with these type of sine waves. And if we have, or if we add up infinitely many number of the sine waves, we will theoretically perfectly approximate the original underlying signal. So we can represent a signal in terms of its sine wave components. This animation will make this a little bit more clear. So we have a bunch of different sine waves that add up to this approximation to the box signal that we have from before. And when we plot these sine waves in terms of their frequencies, then we get a different representation of the original signal. And this is called the frequency domain representation. And it represents essentially which sine waves we need to add up to get the original signal in the end. Which means that we can, instead of the time domain or the spatial domain that the filters move on, we now have a frequency domain, just a different representation of the image that is just represented by how strong a certain frequency sine wave is contributing to the original signal. And this domain is called the frequency domain. This is yet another visualization of this phenomena where we add up different sine waves, and here you can see them put on the unit circle representation. And when we add these up, they actually align very well when the box kernel is getting a sharp decline or sharp increase in the time domain or the spatial domain. And otherwise, they cancel each other, so it stays at a constant level a bit. And then all of them collapses and our signal goes down very quickly, similar to the box kernel. You can find the implementation of this visualization in MATLAB Central, actually. It is linked below. And essentially, just by changing the sine waves we add up, we can generate different waveforms. This one is called a sawtooth waveform because it looks like a sawtooth when it is completely sharp instead of this approximation. But these are 1D signals, and we will look at images as 2D signals today. And this same Fourier series representation can be extended to 2D quite easily, and this visualization of this artwork demonstrates just that. The x-axis and y-axis are working together to create this sketch in the end. This is an excellent example of this, but somehow I couldn't find the original artist who created this visualization. You may not be aware, but we see this frequency representation with audio signals a lot. This is a frequency representation of this audio signal, for example. And in two dimensions, the simple sine waves also become two-dimensional. But some of them are just in the x dimension and some of them are in the y dimension. And when we look at the frequency domain representation, it should also be visible. But with two dimensions, we can also get these type of waves as well. And they would end up having both X and Y frequency components in the frequency representation. And as we are doing this representation by adding up different sine waves, this also works in 2D. So you can add these two different waves to get a third wave, and you will see that in the frequency domain, they are also added up to give you the complex frequency. Before we define our Fourier transform, let's go into MATLAB and see how the images in the frequency domain look. Let's read some images and look at their Fourier transform in MATLAB. I prepared a high frequency and low frequency image, and let's see what they mean. So let's read, let's convert to double and convert to gray and read our low frequency image. And also the high frequency image. And let's have a look at them. Okay, we have one image with bricks of a wall and another one with a person in it. You can see that on the right-hand side image, there are many edges. So we think that it is a high frequency image. And on the left-hand side, there are not as many edges. So the content is mostly low frequency. Let's take the Fourier transform and see. You can take the Fourier transform using the FFT2 function. FFT means fast Fourier transform. This is a type of Fourier transform for discrete images. When we discuss Fourier transform in the class, we will mostly talk about analog or continuous signals for simplicity. Okay. Now, when I am displaying these functions or these frequency responses, I will use the function FFT shift that will help us visualize the frequency components better in MATLAB. And this is because discrete signals have repeating frequencies and we are just shifting the window we are looking at. This will be clearer when we discuss sampling in our next lecture. You can always use the MATLAB help as well. And I will take the absolute value of the frequency response, because as you can see, these frequency responses are complex numbers. We will also discuss it in class, why these are complex and what that means. But when we talk about low frequency and high frequency, we are interested in the magnitude of these complex values. An absolute value function in MATLAB takes the magnitude of complex numbers. That's quite a bit of an explanation. But as you try this out in MATLAB yourself, everything should be much clearer. This is obviously too bright, so let's divide it with something. Let's divide it a little bit further. Okay, so now we can see that on the left hand side image, most of the frequency components are in the center, which is the low frequencies around here in the image. But in the high frequency image, we do have many low frequencies, but we also have a lot of high frequency details like this. These are the edges that appear in the image. This is what we mean by an image with high frequency content and image with a low frequency content, or a low pass image. As you just saw, the frequency domain representation, or the Fourier transform of the image, is actually a complex number. And this is because the sine waves have a frequency as well as a phase. And the phase of a sine wave is defined like this. It is essentially a shift in the spatial domain. And when we compute the frequency domain representation of images, that's why we will get complex numbers. And complex numbers and phase and frequency of a sine wave is related through the Euler formula, as you see here. That is coming from the unit circle definition of sine and cosine, together with the definition of our complex numbers. And we can look at the amplitude of the frequency domain representation, which will give us how much low frequency and how many high frequency components the image has. And in the phase, it will store more of the information, like the complex information we see in the image. As humans, we can't really make sense of the phase of the frequency domain representation, but the magnitude of or amplitude of the representation is very intuitive to us. Because if there are many edges, that means that there are many high frequencies, and if there are not so many edges, there are just smooth surfaces and constant colors, we will have low frequency. Mathematically, Fourier transform is defined this way. But don't let this scare you. We will not go into the details of the mathematics behind Fourier transform. We simply do not have enough time for that. That takes multiple classes usually. But you should understand what this equation represents. The omega you see here is called the angular frequency. It represents our frequency. And some very typical Fourier transform pairs that we will see in 2D in just a minute are like this. The Fourier transform of a box function is called the sinc function, and it goes up and down with the higher frequencies. And as we talked about it in our filtering lecture, the Fourier transform of a Gaussian is another Gaussian. Your reading assignment today will give you more information about Fourier transform pairs. One very important theorem for our purposes and also in general is called the convolution theorem, which states that the convolution operation in the spatial domain is equivalent to multiplication in the frequency domain. And also multiplication in the spatial domain corresponds to convolution in the frequency domain. And this is one of the reasons we like convolution instead of cross-correlation, as we discussed last week as well. Convolving an image in the spatial domain means filtering, which means that we can take the Fourier transform of the kernel and instead of convolving, just multiply the Fourier transforms of the two images and still get the same filtering result. And that's actually how we classify different types of filters. So let's see the frequency response of different signals in MATLAB. Let's define some filters and look at their frequency responses. I am defining one Gaussian filter and one box filter. And we will look at their frequency responses. First, take the frequency, the Fourier transform. Let's make the Fourier transform size the same as the image. Uh, And let's do the same thing for our box filter. Okay, we might need to divide the box filter response a little bit. Okay, now as you can see, the Fourier transform of our Gaussian is yet another Gaussian, but the Fourier transform of our box filter is the sinc function that looks like this in the two-dimensional space. This means that when we filter with this one, it will only keep the low frequencies in the end, but when we filter with the box filter, it will also leave some of the high frequency details, which might look weird in the end. So let's see how that looks like. What happened here? Oh, we did not. Okay, as you can see, this part is very well blurred. But in this one, we have these type of harsh edges and some jumping behavior in general in the image. And when we look at the frequency response of this box filtered image, let's see. I misnamed my variable, so just go with it. As you will see, although our box filter is trying to filter it just to stay inside here, it will leave some of these things around here. And we can actually change our Gauss filter a little bit to match this. See, when we do Gaussian filtering, it will just clean everything outside the low frequency regions. But when we do box filtering, it will not be able to clear out everything outside. So it will create some like weird edges, as we also saw in the last week's lecture. We can also do the same operation by multiplying the two frequency responses. For example, let's create our Gaussian response, and let's filter our image with it. Filtering here, instead of the convolution, it will simply be a per pixel multiplication. And we filter it with our high frequency image. And let's have a look. So we effectively got rid of everything that is outside this Gaussian filter. Let's look at it in a bit nicer way. So we got rid of all the high frequency signals, high frequency parts of the signal. And we can retrieve back our filtered image after the multiplication operation in the frequency domain. By taking the inverse FFT. And then we look at our filtered image. It will be a blurred version of our original image. As you can see. This is called low pass filtering. We can create a high pass filter by subtracting our Gaussian kernel from a filter that doesn't change the image. Because we know that when we subtract the smoothed image from the actual image, we get only the details, only the edges, as we saw in our a sharpening example. So let's create a filter that doesn't do anything to the image. Let's call it one filter and make it zero the size of the Gaussian. And we will make the middle element of our one filter one, which would be the sixth one. So this is our one filter that doesn't do anything to the image, but we can subtract Gaussian from this to get our high pass filter, and let's see how that looks like in the frequency domain. As opposed to our Gaussian filter. See, here it will only pass the high frequency components because this is per pixel multiplication in the frequency domain. And here it will only pass the low frequency components. That's why this one is called the high pass filter and this one is called the low pass filter. We can have a look at the result of our high pass filter using simple image filtering. Although you can also do it in the frequency domain, it doesn't really make a difference in terms of the result. High frequency image. One filter minus Gaussian. Let's multiply it a little bit and see that the result is indeed just the edges of the image, as we would expect from a high pass filter that only preserves the high frequency details. Our required reading today is section 3.4 on Fourier transform. And as further watching, you can check the 3 blue 1 brown video on Fourier transform. And if you want to see a live video of a frequency domain representation, you should check the video by Brian Paul, who shows different types of images and talks about how they appear in the frequency domain. That should clear out many of the questions you may have about how images may look in the frequency domain. Thank you very much for listening, and we will see each other in our follow-up lecture on aliasing and image resizing.